Welcome back. So in the last class, I tried to introduce NOE, for which I brought in the concept of decoupling, both homo and heteronuclear decoupling, how it is done. I said we can saturate one of the spins and see the effect of it in the other spin, which is coupled to. The homonuclear case, we can reduce the multiplicity, collapse this multiplicity, or we can see the change in the intensity, or reduce coupling, or sometimes you can get extra peaks, which we called as spin tickling. So, varieties of things we understood. And then I wanted to take two spins which are uncoupled and closed in space with a dipolar interaction. You worked out from the energy level diagram, I briefed you what is W1, W2, W0, which are transition probabilities for the spins. So, we wanted to understand, because of irradiation with the second radio frequency, I said NOE occurs and then there will be change in the intensity of the observed peak. After radiating somewhere we will see the change in the peak, change in the intensity of the peak. So, to test that, what we did is, we took two uncoupled spins, took the population difference in such a way, which were based Boltzmann distribution, and then calculated the intensity of both the coupled spins, both the spins. It was transitions of same intensity for both. Then we saturated spins, transitions corresponding to one spin, and again recalculated the population difference. And we did not see any change in the intensity. And then wait for some time, after I remove the RF, the system will go back to thermal equilibrium. So nothing much interesting happened in spite of irradiating with the second radio frequency pulse. So I said, there must be some other mechanism. Otherwise, how do we get the NOE? For that, we require what is called dipole-dipole interactions. So we are going to discuss today about dipole-dipole interaction and relaxation mechanism through double quantum and zero quantum transition pathways. So, in the presence of irradiation of a spin, the transition probabilities have various effects. One, W8 and WS1. This is, there is no effect since the A is irradiated, and there was no effect since S is already in equilibrium in the presence of irradiation of one of the spins. This is what we observed. Now, let us do one thing. Since this did not work out for us, why not we think of the way the spin system can relax in a different pathway? See, after the spin system has to attain thermal equilibrium, the relaxation pathway chosen was single quantum. See, we remember we had the energy levels, two energies level, we had different energy levels, we saturated one of them, and then when we saturated this, we saw this one and this one, whatever the things which were allowed, there was no change in the intensity because these are all single quantum transitions we were looking at. But on the other hand, now let us see what happens if the only possible way for the spins to relax is either this or this. Of course, this is also possible. There are competitive processes. I'm not excluding any of them. But let us assume, for the time being, the only possible way for the spins to come back to thermal equilibrium is this way, double quantum, or this way, it is single quantum. You understand, double quantum is plus alpha, alpha to beta, beta. Zero quantum is alpha, beta to beta, alpha. This is for forbidden transition as far as the detection is concerned. But I said, in the context of relaxation, they are allowed. Now, let us see, if we follow that path, how does it work? Now, consider zero and double quantum transitions in the presence of irradiating field. See how the spins get redistributed into the new equilibrium. Now, we have saturated spins. Peaks correspond to A1 and A2. The A spin is saturated. We start from that point. And after some time, when we calculate the intensity, A0, this A0, and this was 2, there was no effect. That's what was our conclusion. Now let us do one thing. Let us see, we'll wait for some time after irradiation, allow spins to relax through double quantum pathway, where W2 is probable. You are thinking it will go back like this and then attain thermal equilibrium. You are always thinking the W1 was the possibility. Let us think of W2 possibility. Let us say the nuclear spins comes down like this. It will relax like this. And this is the situation. Now what is going to happen? Let us see. Calculate the population difference between energy levels of X. X transition here is 3 minus 1, 4 minus 1, it is 3, and this transition 3 minus 0 is 3. What did we do? We didn't know, we did not do anything. We had saturated these spins, and then after that, one spin was here after saturation of both A transitions, but we allowed this to not go through the single quantum pathway. We allowed it to directly jump here to come through double quantum pathway. That is the relaxation mechanism I am allowing it. Now when I recalculated the population difference and intensity, earlier it was 2-2, now it became 3-3. I did not do anything, no magic, just earlier calculation was, population difference was calculated by using single quantum pathway like this. Now when it came from double, when I allowed it to come through double quantum pathway, then if you recalculate, intensity is made up 3-3. So what is happening now? Just because you irradiated A spins, X spin has gone up by intensity by 50%. It was 2-2, now it became 3. 50% gain in the intensity of the peaks. You agree? Now, the 50% gain is called a positive energy. Okay. Now, we will do one more thing. Keep on continuing for low power irradiation and leave it for some time. After some time, what will happen? It will come back to thermal equilibrium. This is what the started case before applying RF power. So, it has to come to thermal equilibrium. You can't keep on applying RF power for infinite time. After some time, you remove RF power. Slowly, system will come back to equilibrium. And this is the population distribution, Boltzmann distribution at equilibrium. Now, we will do the another possibility. Again, we consider a situation, spins A, but both the transitions, possible transitions of A are again saturated. We irradiated and saturated these with low power RF. Now, instead of allowing the spin to come from here to here, there is the double quantum relaxation pathway, why not I allow this to go to zero quantum pathway? That is also allowed as far as the relaxation is concerned. Let us see what happens if this spin goes like this. Now, find out the intensity pattern for X. Now, when this is saturated, when this became equal, the spin, the zero quantum relaxation pathway occurred, and the spin which was saturated here, X spin, came through zero quantum pathway and came here. What is happening now? Calculate the intensity for X. 3 minus 1, it is 2. It is 2 minus 1, X. 3, I'm sorry, here it is, there is 1. 3 minus 2, it is 1. 2 minus 1, it is 1. So, the transitions for X, earlier it was 3-3. If I allow the spins to go through 0 quantum, it became 1-1. Now, let me summarize for you. When the spins were undergoing relaxation through normal pathway, there was no change in the intensity. All were equal to 2. Right? Now, when I allow, after saturation, allow the spin to come to relax to the ground state, alpha alpha, through double quantum pathway, then intensity of the X transition went up by 50%. 3. From 2, it went to 3. On the other hand, if I consider this relaxation pathway, what is happening? Intensity came down by 50%. This is called negative NOEA. Understand? This is called negative NOEA. So, the relaxation with zero quantum pathway possibility gives you negative NOEA. Relaxation from with a double quantum pathway gives you positive NOI. Of course, after some time, continual low power decoupling, and then after some time, nothing will happen. The system will go to thermal equilibrium. So, what is the final summary of NOI? If there is a W1 probability, single quantum, that will not create NOI at all. Supposing in your molecule, this is the most efficient relaxation pathway, this one. In your experiment, whatever you do, you will not get NOI signal. Because this relaxation pathway's dominant is W1, and that is not in your hands to control. You can't control it. If the system, naturally, if it is like that one, so you may not get NOI at all. On the other hand, if W2 is the efficient pathway of this thing, then you will get positive. This can happen only for small molecules which is undergoing fast motion and motional frequency is quite large. Okay. It should be at the double the Larmor frequency. So motional frequency is quite large frequency. If W0 is efficient, that is the relaxation pathway. Generally, it can happen for large molecules which undergo slow motions, small frequency differences, it gives negative NOI. If they remember three cases, if the relaxation is through W1, no NOI, the efficient relaxation pathway is double quantum W2, then positive NOI. If the relaxation is efficient through zero quantum pathway, is negative NOI. This is what happens, but in reality, what happens, none of them are exclusive processes. They are not exclusive. They are all competing processes. You cannot tell the nuclear is going to dictate a nuclear is going to do what you want. In reality, everything is going on. It can be W1, W2, W, all relaxation pathways are allowed. Now, observation of the NOE, detection of NOE in your sample depends upon which is the dominant relaxation pathway for you. Okay, if W2 is the dominant relaxation pathway, much greater than W0, then NOE will be positive. If W0 is greater than W2, then NOE will be negative. If W2 is equal to W0, no NOE at all. Very difficult situations you come across, right? So, this is the important concept. NOE, you should know basics of NOE. The relaxation pathway of this irradiated spin, how they relax, defines whether it is a positive NOE or negative NOE. Okay. And this is generally what happens is we are saturating the transitions for a period of time and allow this system to attain steady state because of various competition mechanism. That is why this experiment is called steady state NOE. You allow saturate the transition for a period of time. Especially longer than its T1 time, it cannot be faster. Then allow it to go through the competitive processes, and then eventually, after some time, you will measure the NOE. This is called steady state NOE. As I said, we have transient NOE, driven NOE, various things. I am not rotating for frame NOE, that's called ROSI. Really, we don't have time to discuss all those things, but I just tell you this is enough to understand steady state NOE for you. Okay, the Z magnetization in the gain in the signal intensity is given by Solomon equation. It is a qualitative treatment of equations. Solomon has done that and is given an equation like this. So, if I look at the spin MZX, what is the gain in the X nuclei with respect to the equilibrium, can be given by simple equation, and this is a NOE term. And depends upon W2 minus W0 and all the three relaxation pathways. It is an equation which has been worked out by Solomon. The numerator W2 minus 0, W0 is called crash relaxation time or crash relaxation constant. And this is called sigma is. It denoted as sigma is. Don't worry. This is a difference between double quantum, zero quantum pathway. The denominator is there, you know. Here, the sum of all the three. This is called longitudinal dipolar relaxation. If this is cross relaxation, it is dipolar relaxation. Okay. Now, when I say all the things are going on competitively, how do you know what is the rate of these processes? How do you find out what are the possible processes of undergoing this type of transition? What is the transition probability? How do you know which is going on first, W2, W0, W1, which is dominant? What defines this process? This is defined by what is called spectral density function. What is the spectral density function? It is a function which is given by JW. It is, let us say, there are molecular motional fluctuations are there. Lot of fluctuating magnetic field will be developed because of the various possible motions in the molecule, in the nucleus, or at the site of the nuclear spin. This is a time domain perturbation. It perturbs with time. It undergoing changes with time. It is a signal you can collect in time and do the Fourier transformation. What you will get? You will get a frequency. So this type of fluctuating magnetic field, it has certain different frequencies. You can do the Fourier transformation of time domain fluctuating signal and you will get the frequency. And that is called spectral density function. So without going more into the details, I tell you what is a spectral density function depend upon. It depends upon the motion of the spins and on the Larmor frequency. It depends upon two things. First, it depends upon the motion. Of course, I was telling you in the previous also, which is a dominant spin mechanism, relaxation mechanism depends upon whether the small molecule or big molecule. I told you, no. In the case of small molecule, I showed which is dominant. Big molecule, slow motion, I told you W0 is dominant. Fine. Now, let us take the example of a 400 MHz spectrometer. If you record the spectrum on a 400 MHz spectrometer and calculate the molecular fluctuating field generated everything and do the Fourier transformation, take the time domain function of that and calculate the spectral density function, it is 400 MHz. W1 will be 400 MHz. And W2 is always double the Larmor frequency I told you. It has to require two quantum of energy. It's the single quantum of energy at 400 MHz is 400 MHz. Double quantum energy is 800 MHz. What is W0? It's the difference in the chemical shifts of the order of few kilohertz. So at dominant mechanisms, at a particular frequency, it depends upon various things. First, Larmor frequency and motion of the spin. Supposing it's the same molecule, take it to 800 MHz. W1 is 800 and W2 is 1600 MHz. Your fluctuating field may not have that large frequency. Then this is not a dominant mechanism. You understand? So on the other hand, you go to, let us say, from 800 go to 100 MHz. W1 is 100 and W2 is 200. It's quite likely the fluctuating mechanism, that molecule, the motion is such that you may have 200 MHz, maybe easily achievable. So it depends upon the Larmor frequency, which depends upon the magnetic field. Okay. So W1, W2, W0 are proportional to the Larmor frequency. Whatever the spectrometer frequency you are considering, W1 corresponds to that Larmor frequency, W2 is twice the Larmor frequency, W0 equal to difference of the chemical shifts you have to get. Okay. And this is the distribution of frequencies of the oscillating dipolar interaction. It is all oscillating dipolar interactions because of these motions generate fluctuating fields and that has all these frequencies. Clear? What is the spectral density function? It is nothing but frequency distribution obtained because of the oscillating dipolar interactions are always undergoing oscillations. So it won't be steady. And then the time domain function, if you do the way Fourier transformation, that's what you get, frequency domain. So for small molecules in low viscosity solvents, molecular motion is faster than Larmor frequency. So deep, leading the dominating is W2 minus W2. Small molecules, the motional frequency is such that it is always faster than Larmor frequency. So in 200 MHz, if you take, molecular motion will be 400 MHz frequency. So what is the dominant mechanism? W2. So double quantum is relaxation is efficient with positive NV. Now if I take bigger molecules, very, very big molecules, then motion may not be very fast. then other one is dominating. So depending upon the field and the oscillating frequency, you know which is dominant, whether you get positive NOE or negative NOE, you can discuss. Now for all these things, there is a simple relation like this. W2:W1:W0 is given by 12:3:2. So depending upon which is dominating, which is this thing, you can put these values in the Solomon equation. So you will get how you will come to know what is the gain in the signal intensity because of NOE. Okay. So for homonuclear spins, maximum gain is 50%. That is the equation. I have to show you that. Where is that equation? I didn't give you that equation. Okay, doesn't matter. I'll come later. Okay. So there is a Solomon equation where the ratio, I think I showed Solomon equation, the ratio of gamma x to gamma is there. That will define, okay, along with these factors, there was a, okay, W2-W0 was at the numerator. I said that is a cross relaxation term. I told you, you know. So based on that, which term is dominating, because the ratio is given like this for the small molecules, you can find out what is the maximum NOE you are going to get. When both are homonuclear case, when gammas of both are equal, then you get maximum NOE is 50%. This is not just for one molecule, in a given molecule, for example, one spin can experience NOE with varieties of other protons which are close in space. Doesn't matter. This can have NOE with this, NOE with this, NOE with this. Now each of them cannot give 0.5, 0.5, 0.5 and add up to 2. No. Not that you will get 200% enhancement in intensity. Together, each individual NOE, if you calculate, the maximum NOE cannot be more than 50%. It should be less than or equal to 50%. It cannot exceed 50%. This is for small molecules in low viscosity solvents. Why I said low viscosity? The viscosity is more, the motional frequency is less. It cannot rotate freely, you know. Tumbling motion frequency is much less. So for large molecules are in a viscous solution, this is the dominant. And NOE turns out to be minus 1. Remember, for large molecule, NOE is minus 1. For small molecule, NOE is plus 0.5. So, one case, small molecule positive NOE, large molecule negative NOE. Maximum enhancement for small molecule positive NOE is 50%. And the large molecules is minus 1, minus 100%. Okay. Now, this is where I wanted to show you. How do these fluctuating fields arise? The spins, let us say in the solution, motion is rotation of the molecule. The spins are always aligned with respect to magnetic field. But spins, molecule undergoes turns, it will not just staying idle. You know, it is undergoing motions. It rotates and then turns. And then, as a consequence, what happens? The small microscopic dipoles which are present gives fluctuating magnetic fields. The fluctuating dipoles gives magnetic fields. And that has a frequency, okay? That rotational frequency defines this spectral density and everything, okay? Now we have a rotational correlation time, another thing, which tells about the motion of the molecules. Whether the molecules are undergoing fast motion or slow motion, how do you find out? The rotational correlation time is another term which tells you about the, see, the tau c is nothing but the time required for the molecule to go one to undergo rotation by 1 radian. Okay, if the molecule undergoes rotation by 1 radian, how much time it requires? That is called correlation time. The definition of correlation time is the time required for the molecules to undergo rotation by 1 radian. And that is what it is. So the tau c correlates, and now the orientation of the molecule at two different fit times and depends upon several factors. The tau c depends upon several factors. One is molecular weight, mainly molecular weight. Sluggish molecule cannot rotate faster. You see, you take a small ball, you can rotate very fast. You can't rotate an elephant faster, right? Molecules become bigger and bigger. It will become more and more sluggish. It cannot rotate faster. The size of the molecule also matters. Okay. So the rotation correlation times, which depends upon the motion of the molecule, depends upon molecular size, molecular weight. Okay. Basically, tau C tells you about the sluggishness of the molecule. Shorter the tau c means fast random motion. Tau c is longer means molecule is very big and sluggish, very lazy, very sluggish molecule. In which case, tau c is very long. It takes more time to undergo one rotation. And this is a simple example to show. These are the small molecules which can undergo rapid tumbling. These are the large molecules, sluggish molecules, tumble very slowly. So the rule of thumb, you can calculate the tau c, what is the correlation time, is always expressed in nanoseconds. It is approximately for a spherical macromolecule like a big protein, it is of the order up to 25 kilodalton. Then this is a general thumb, right hand, not general thumb rule. General thumb rule is tau c is 0.6 times the molecular weight. So for a small protein, let us say of 3 to 4 kilodalton, tau c is about 2 nanoseconds. So this 2 nanosecond tau c, you calculate the frequency, it turns out to be 500 megahertz. That is the Larmor frequency of a 500 megahertz spectrometer. Okay. So motions with higher frequency will be absent for a perfectly rigid molecule. For a perfectly rigid molecule, that is absent. So spectral density at the twice the Larmor frequency is small for proteins. That's what I said. So that is the reason why we understood what is W2, W0, which is dominant. Okay. So zero frequency component spectral density function increases with increasing molecular weight. The rotational frequency becomes lower and lower. This I will show you by drawing here, figure. Look at this one. The total amount of oscillating field is a constant. Whether the area of this, area of this, area of this, whatever you take, a constant. But upper limit of the frequency varies with the correlation time. What is the frequency? It varies with the correlation time. So one can draw a graph of these things. And for omega tau c molecule, you can take omega is the Larmor frequency, tau c is the correlation time. Multiply these two factors. If it is very much larger than one, this spectral density function follows this path. And in this region, it relaxes very fast. If omega is approximately equal to 1, this is your Larmor frequency, then you will not be able to get NOE at all. If omega dose is very much smaller than 1, the spread in frequency is quite large here. Okay, this is very, very large here. So the simple logic is omega dose is smaller than 1, molecule tumbles fast and you get positive. It is called extreme narrowing condition. Omega tau c is larger than 1, molecule tumbles very slowly and negative enhancement. This is called a diffusion limit. Please understand these points very clearly. When omega tau c is approximately equal to 1, it is correct value is 1.106, I think. Okay. In this limit, NOE goes to 0. So omega into tau c, Larmor frequency into correlation time of the molecule, defines and tells you whether your NOE is positive, negative, or zero. Remember, when I started this class, I told you there are several factors on which NOE depends. It depends upon the correlation time, that is, size of the molecule, motion of the molecule, magnetic field, which depends upon the Larmor frequency, and the relaxation pathway, various reasons. For NOE, the NOE depends upon various mechanism I explained to you. This is the gist I wanted to tell you. NOE, we discuss about the relaxation pathway. We know W2 and W0, which is dominant to give positive or negative NOE, we understood. And now we understood about the correlation time. And we based on the correlation time and Larmor frequency, we know what are the spectral density functions. The spectral density function, it is JW, what is that? Based on that W0, W1 or W2, we know which is dominating. That depends upon, again, molecular motions, tau c. So now taking tau c and W both into account, we know whether molecules give positive NOE, negative NOE or zero. And this is the dependence of NOE on the factor omega into tau c. See, in this case, NOE is the measured NOE. This is taken from this journal, this paper. See, for small molecules, see, this is becoming like this, it's going like this, and here it becomes larger. This side is a large molecule, this side is a small molecule, and exactly at this place, it will cross our point, NOE is zero. That is the place where omega tau c is close to 0. I'm sorry, 1.106 close to, and NOE is 0. Omega tau c is 1.106 here, and that is the situation, no NOE. And in this case, small molecule case, 0.5 intensity, positive intensity, negative intensity, 100% here. To overcome this 0 NOE problem, an NOE, different type of NOE experiment is done called rotating frame overall effect, ROE. I don't think I have time to discuss that. Maybe at the end of the class, if there is time, at the end of the course, if one or two class of time is left for me, I'll take some special topic like this, which I have not covered. So it may not be sequential, but I pick up specific points and then try to give you the idea. But at the moment, we will not worry. But please remember one thing, ROE overcomes the problem of zero intensity cases. Okay. And this is NOE depends upon the distance also, I told you. The strength of dipole interaction depends upon RIJ. And we need two dipoles to have a dipolar coupling. As a consequence, NOE depends upon inverse of RIJ cube into RIJ cube. It is RIJ to the power of 6. So the intensity of our NOE depends upon inverse 6th power of the distance. Remember, inverse 6th power of the distance. So small variation in the distance, if you slightly move away from 1 angstrom, 2 angstrom, NOE drastically comes. Okay? NOE depends upon this, 2 split this, and Ws will depend upon this. As a consequence, NOE is distance dependent. If they move away, NOE drastically comes down. So in the case of heteronuclear case, we can see what is this thing. Homonuclear case, gamma A is equal to gamma X, like this. So maximum NOE is 50%. But in the heteronuclear case, gamma A is different from gamma X. Take for example carbon. This is proton, this is carbon. Then you can see the intensity is different. NOE is important especially for low gamma nuclei, where gamma matters a lot. There can be maximum enhancement of the signal. This is precisely what we saw in carbon 13 NMR, where we did the decoupling with NOE, got more signal to noise ratio. When we did the broadband decoupling, remember in carbon 13, I told you it had an NOE factor built in. That's why in the heteronuclear case, especially with low gamma, this NOE factor is very important to get the better signal to noise ratio. So you can calculate, let us say this is the saturated spin. And this is the observed spin for intensity change. Now put it into this is the equation. Please note down this equation. It's very important. And then I is not is the original intensity. And what is the gain in the intensity as a factor of eta, which depends upon gamma. If you put it into that, then for the case of proton, when proton is decoupled, carbon 13 is observed, you say gamma A into two times gamma X, calculate it is 202. So there is a 200% enhancement in the case of carbon if I decouple proton and observe carbon. That is why we got better signal to noise ratio when we decoupled proton and observed carbon. On the other hand, I can decouple carbon and observe proton. That's also possible. In which case, gamma ray will change the numerator to denominator, gamma change. So now you put those gamma values, it turns out to be 12.5. Enhancement is not much, it's only 12.5. Because you are decoupling carbon 13, low gamma nuclei, and observing proton, high gamma spin. This thing. So, advantage is you have to decouple high gamma spin and look at the low gamma nuclei. There is a better enhancement of the signal. That's what happens. And this is how the steady state NOE is done. First, what you do a steady state NOE is, I think now if I start explaining this, it will take more time. What I'm going to do is, I have covered a lot about NOE in the two class. In the next class, I'll just tell you what is steady state NOE, how we measure it experimentally. And then I'll change over to a different topic.